will check up the first during pregnancy.
Today we are going to discuss about this cyanotic congenital heart disease. Dear friends, as all you know that congenital heart disease produce cyanosis when obstruction to right ventricle outflow cause that can be intracardiac right to left shunting mainly, but there are lots of other reasons. We know lots of diseases like tetralogy of Fallot's, hypoplastic left heart syndrome and tricuspid atresia. All these diseases they produce the cyanotic congenital heart disease. Congenital heart disease occurs in 0.3 to 0.8% per live birth. So there are huge number of infant born with congenital heart disease, especially like India like country. They are more than 1 billion populations are there. Today to discuss the clinical evaluation of cyanotic congenital heart disease, we are having experts from Ascot Hospital, Dr. Radhakrishnan. I would like to welcome you, sir.
Thank
we
you.
Are very happy that sir is there. He is the renowned pediatric cardiologist and he is going to discuss about the clinical evaluation of cyanotic congenital heart disease.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. And I think I'll straight away go on to the topic of evaluation of congenital heart disease. As been instructed to you, I'm really not going into the details of the subject because as PGDCC students, I would like you to just understand the basis of how we evaluate patients of cyanotic congenital heart diseases. And it would be restricted to the clinical evaluation, subsequently ECG, and I hope later on in some other session I would get time to talk to you about how we look at the ECG of X-rays of cyanotic congenital heart disease and briefly about the echocardiography. The most important at your level is trying to understand the physiological basis of cyanosis as to why in cyanotic congenital heart disease cyanosis occurs. And then subsequently, once you have understood this, we have to go on to the clinical information, X-ray, ECG, and echocardiography. In my clinical evaluation today, I will be very briefly talking about X-ray and ECG. It will not be in as much as detail because I have to cover the whole topic. But finally, when we reach a diagnosis of cyanotic congenital heart disease, we have to take into consideration all these informations: clinical, X-ray, ECG, and echocardiography. But before that, you have to understand why cyanosis occurs in cyanotic congenital heart disease. There are lots of causes of cyanosis in cyanotic congenital heart disease. The most important one which has been mentioned is the pulmonary blood flow. And remember that cyanosis to occur in cyanotic congenital heart disease is inversely proportional to the pulmonary blood flow. Therefore, the lower the pulmonary blood flow, the greater the degree of cyanosis, and this is one of the most important determinant of cyanosis in cyanotic congenital heart disease. The second reason why cyanosis occurs in cyanotic congenital heart diseases is abnormalities of mixing. And a typical example is in a patient who has only one ventricle, functioning one ventricle, where both the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood mix in that chamber and therefore is responsible for cyanosis. Origin of aorta from the ventricle, which is typically known as transposition of great arteries, also contributes to cyanosis. As an example, for the same degree of pulmonary stenosis, if a patient has an aorta coming out from the right ventricle, the child is likely to have more cyanosis as compared to aorta coming off from the left ventricle. That's because the deoxygenated blood is directly ejected into the aorta and therefore contributes to the degree of cyanosis. And of course, you are all aware that hemoglobin is a very important determinant of the clinical recognition of cyanosis. And we all know that a certain degree of reduced hemoglobin is necessary for us to pick up the cyanosis. And therefore, anemia masks cyanosis. We all know that, and it is very common in our country for babies or children to be suffering from both congenital heart disease as well as anemia due to various reasons. Anemia is not a very important cause in the Western population because you don't see anemia in growing up children very often unless there are some abnormal causes. But anemia will mask cyanosis, and polycythemia will exaggerate cyanosis, and we all understand this right from our MBBS teaching. So a baby is cyanotic because the blood delivered to the systemic circulation is without oxygen, and this is typically called the right to left shunt. So all the deoxygenated blood which reaches the systemic arterial blood mixes with the blood which is oxygenated, and this is called the right to left shunting, and that is what is mainly responsible for cyanosis. Remember that cyanosis can be uniform and it can be differential. When we say uniform cyanosis, we mean that there is a right to left shunt at the atrial level or the ventricular level or the ascending aorta level. So if a patient has cyanosis because of congenital heart disease, he or she should have right to left shunt at the atrial, ventricular or the ascending aorta level. If there is differential cyanosis, it indicates right to left shunt across the patent ductus arteriosus with severe pulmonary arterial hypertension. This is the only way that differential cyanosis can occur, that is right to left shunt through the patent ductus arteriosus. It is irrelevant whether there is coarctation of aorta or not in this whole setting. So if you detect differential cyanosis, it always means that there is a PDA which is shunting right to left in the presence of severe pulmonary hypertension. Now if you look at this chart, you can have two types of differential cyanosis. What is the usual differential cyanosis that you know, and what is known as the reverse differential cyanosis. So if you look at the chart, we have shown two areas, that is the fingers and toes, and there are two color coding there, the blue and the red. Red means acyanotic blood, blue blood means deoxygenated blood. So let's compare the fingers and toes. If you think that the fingers are more blue than the toes, it basically indicates that there is reverse differential cyanosis, and this is typical of transposition of great vessels. The one which is more common and which you more commonly see are where the fingers are red, that is, it is not cyanosed, but the toes are blue. That is the second column line which you see, and this indicates normal connections of great vessels. So to summarize this, differential cyanosis occurs when there is a right to left shunt through the patent ductus arteriosus and severe pulmonary hypertension. If the fingers are more blue than the toes, it indicates transposition of great vessels. So if you want a full diagnosis, it will be transposition of great vessel, severe pulmonary hypertension, and right to left shunt through the patent ductus arteriosus. If the fingers are not blue but the toes are blue, the final diagnosis will be severe pulmonary hypertension, right to left shunt through the patent ductus arteriosus, but with normally connected great vessels. So this is how you evaluate differential cyanosis. This is a pictorial diagram, and you see how important pulmonary blood flow contributes to cyanosis. In the extreme left hand picture, you see there is a lot of red occurring within the area. If you compare the blue and red shaded areas, you see that the red area is more than the blue area. Basically, it indicates that the pulmonary blood flow is good. If you come to the extreme right picture, you will see that the contribution of the red is much less than that of the blue. which means that the pulmonary blood flow is less. And in the middle picture, it is a middle of the two, that is, there is a balanced pulmonary blood flow. And then if you look at the final result, you will see that the patient who is on the extreme right hand corner, that is the patient who has very little pulmonary blood flow, is the patient who is going to be more blue, as compared to the extreme left hand corner picture, where you see that there is good pulmonary blood flow, and the final result which you see at the bottom is that the patient is not very blue. And therefore, as we keep on emphasizing, the most important determinant of a patient who is going to have cyanosis clinically is the degree of pulmonary blood flow. So if the pulmonary blood flow is less, the cyanosis is going to be more. If the pulmonary blood flow is not less, then the cyanosis can be masked, in spite of the fact that this patient has cyanotic heart disease. And I'll come to this later, because there are two groups of cyanotic congenital heart disease which I'll discuss, one with increased pulmonary blood flow and the other with decreased pulmonary blood flow. And I'll come to that, and you will understand why this particular diagram is extremely important for you to understand what are the determinants of cyanosis. The purpose of clinical recognition of cyanotic congenital heart disease is not to diagnose the lesion exactly. It is not important for you to be happy and say, look, this is transposition of great vessels with VSTPS, or to try to clinically diagnose important lesions, because most of the time it is not possible, and now in the era of echocardiography it is not necessary. What you essentially have to diagnose is the physiological problem. Is this patient having decreased pulmonary blood flow? Is he having increased pulmonary blood flow? That is what is important for you to understand and diagnose clinically. Finally, narrow down the differential diagnosis to a group, that is the group which I will be discussing about to you later. Then finally, try to recognize, are there any unusual features which tries to make a diagnosis more clear about a particular lesion? Remember that on clinical recognition of any cyanotic heart disease or any heart diseases, you will always have daily surprises, but then one should not be disappointed about it, because even at this level we make mistakes clinically. But then nowadays you always have the support of echocardiography, X-ray, ECG, etc. So one usually does not miss important lesions. As we usually classify the cyanotic congenital heart disease, we have patients of cyanosis with decreased pulmonary blood flow, cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow, cyanosis with normal pulmonary blood flow. Now this is a very unusual group, I will discuss about this later with you. Abnormalities of mixing, which means basically that there is neither too much of increased pulmonary blood flow or too much of decreased pulmonary blood flow, but there is problems of mixing of the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. A typical example is one which I talked to you about, single ventricle. Transposition of great vessel is also a disease which has got abnormalities of mixing, because the aorta directly arises from the right ventricle, and therefore all the deoxygenated blood is directly ejected into the aorta. So it might not strictly follow under the category of decreased and increased pulmonary blood flow. And then of course you can have combination. For example, you can have transposition with a large VST. You can have transposition with a large VST with pulmonary stenosis. So all type of combination, permutations and combinations can occur within this classification. But the two classic groups are the ones with decreased pulmonary blood flow and the ones with increased pulmonary blood flow. Cyanosis with decreased pulmonary blood flow, remember that, as I discussed with you in that diagram, is often associated with either pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia, and that is what makes it a decreased pulmonary blood flow. So either you'll have pulmonary stenosis or you'll have pulmonary atresia. Usually in these patients, a large VST is almost always associated, and so therefore there is a combination of a large ventricular septal defect with either pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia. Very rarely you can have no VST, but the cause of cyanosis in them is, with pulmonary stenosis there will be a right to left shunt at the atrial level. When a patient has VST, then the right to left shunt occurs at the ventricular level. When there is no VST then the right to left shunt will occur at the atrial level and will cause cyanosis. So you'll have pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia with an AST, and the cause of cyanosis would be right to left shunt at the atrial level. And there is a very rare subgroup of patients without pulmonary stenosis also. So there is no VST and there is no pulmonary stenosis. In them, usually the right ventricle is very small, and because of the very small right ventricle, there will be shunting of the blood across the atrial septum because of the very restricted entry of blood into the right ventricle. All the blood tends to get shunted across the atrial septal defect. So again, to summarize this slide, cyanosis with decreased pulmonary blood flow means pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia and a large VST. So majority of patients will have large VST with pulmonary stenosis or atresia. In the ones who do not have a VST, the right to left shunt and cyanosis occurs because there is shunting at the atrial level. They can have pulmonary stenosis or no pulmonary stenosis. So in order of importance, it is VST with pulmonary stenosis, then ASD with pulmonary stenosis, but very rarely there will be only ASD without pulmonary stenosis but a small right ventricle. So this is a very important slide for you to understand. Cyanosis with decreased pulmonary blood flow can have two types of ventriculo-arterial connection, that is, how the ventricle is connected to the great arteries. It can be concordant, which means that the aorta is arising from the left ventricle and the pulmonary artery is arising from the right ventricle. A typical example is patients of tetralogy of Fallot, which is the most common cause of cyanotic congenital heart disease. There is a second group of patients where the aorta arises from the right ventricle and the pulmonary artery from the left ventricle, and this group is called the transposition group. So a typical example is transposition of great arteries, ventricular septal defect with pulmonary stenosis. Both of these patients have decreased pulmonary blood flow, but the difference between the two group is, one, the aorta arises from the left ventricle. In the second, the aorta arises from the right ventricle. It is not difficult now for you to understand that the second group of patients, that is one in which the aorta arises from the right ventricle, is likely to be more blue than in a patient of tetralogy. Because remember my first two or three slides, I said one of the contributors of cyanosis is how the aorta is connected to the ventricle. If the aorta is connected to the right ventricle, more cyanosis is likely to occur for the same degree of decreased pulmonary blood flow. There are other types of connections which you see, double outlet right ventricle, single outlet, but double outlet right ventricle basically means both the aorta and the pulmonary artery arises from the right ventricle. It is not important for you to go into so much of detail, but you have to understand that various types of connections can occur in these group of patients. Normal connection, discordant connection, that is transposition, double outlet connection, and finally single outlet connection. So all these four possibilities are possible. We then come to cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow. Remember that cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow basically means that there is no pulmonary stenosis. So the question arises that if there is no pulmonary stenosis, then how can cyanosis occur? In all of these patients, without exception, except one of them which I will discuss with you later, the great vessels are abnormally related, and that is what is contributing to the cyanosis. So the most important group of these patients are transposition with great vessel with large ventricular septal defect. These patients are minimally cyanosed, and you can understand why if you go back to that diagram again as to why these patients would be minimally cyanosed, but they will always be cyanosed even if you are not able to detect them clinically, because clinical detection of cyanosis requires an oxygen saturation to be at least below 85% for a doctor to have to diagnose this. In these group of patients, if you take a saturation the saturation would be somewhere between 85% to 90%, indicating that there is a large pulmonary blood flow, but because the great vessels are abnormally related, there will always be cyanosis. A typical example, as I showed you, is transposition with VST. You can have patients of double outlet right ventricle, common trunk, which basically means truncus arteriosus. Then there are various rare subgroup. In this group of patients with cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow, there is only one group of patients in which the great vessels are normally related. And the most important of these are patients with total anomalous pulmonary venous connection. So patients with total anomalous pulmonary venous connection is an exception to the rule that cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow will always have an abnormally related great vessels. Here the great vessel will be normally related, and you know the cause of cyanosis in patients with TAPVC is because all the pulmonary blood flow is actually mixing with the abnormal blood flow, that is the desaturated blood, and that is contributing to the pulmonary blood flow, to the cyanosis. How do they clinically present? Cyanosis with decreased pulmonary blood flow, a classic example is tetralogy of Fallot, are usually will have a quiet precordium, that is there will not be too much of activity in the precordium when you clinically inspect the precordium. When you examine them, there will be no cardiomegaly. They will have a grade 3 or more ejection murmur, and that ejection murmur is usually almost always arising from the pulmonary stenosis. So the murmur in these group of patients is because of pulmonary stenosis. Remember that the VST in these patients are always silent because it's a large VST. Both the right and left ventricular pressures are equal. So the VST does not contribute to the murmur. It is the pulmonary stenosis which contributes to the murmur. They will have no flow murmur. What is a flow murmur? Flow murmur means when there is increased pulmonary blood flow, there will be increased return to the ventricle, and therefore that will cause flow murmurs. I will discuss this with you when you come to increased pulmonary blood flow. So there will be no flow murmur. So this is a negative finding. Also remember that cyanosis in these patients is inversely proportional to the severity of ventricular, that is the largeness of the ventricular defects, and the directly with the intact septum. So the patients will be much bluer if they have greater degree of cyanosis, greater degree of pulmonary stenosis. You can hear continuous murmurs in patients of decreased pulmonary blood flow, but never with increased pulmonary blood flow. The cause of continuous murmur in these group of patients is either a PDA or an aortopulmonary collateral. So, in a patient of pulmonary atresia, instead of hearing the ejection murmur, you will hear a continuous murmur because there is no antegrade flow through the pulmonary valve. So there will be no murmur from the pulmonary stenosis from the pulmonary valve. There will be no murmur from the VST. So all you might hear is a continuous murmur. So you should be very careful while you are examining a patient. If you are diagnosing PDA in a patient whom you have clinically examined, always try to look for cyanosis. Because in one, you'll have only PDA. If a patient is cyanosed, then it becomes a complex heart disease like pulmonary atresia. Then finally, the second heart sound. The second heart sound is widely split with a soft pulmonary component. And the reason why it is widely split with a soft pulmonary component is because of pulmonary stenosis. So if there is pulmonary stenosis, which there is always in patients of decreased pulmonary blood flow, the P2 will be delayed, it will occur later, and it will be soft because of pulmonary stenosis. So this is a typical finding, that delayed P2 with soft P2, sometimes the P2 is so soft that you might not be able to hear it. So in the majority of patients, you will have a single second heart sound. And that is why it is said that tetralogy of Fallot has a single second heart sound. Actually, it does not have a single second heart sound. If you go to phonocardiography and all, you will always be able to pick up the pulmonary component of the second heart sound. But you cannot hear it because a human ears might not be able to hear such soft pulmonary component of the second sound. Only in pulmonary atresia, where there is no pulmonary valve and there is no flow across the pulmonary valve, the P2 is truly absent. During clinical examination, as in all medical fields, there are always exceptions. You know, there this thing is hard and fast. So one has always got to be beware of things. And what are the pitfalls of these clinical pictures, clinical classification? One is if the patient is severely polycythemic because of long-standing severe hypoxia, and you specially see them during adolescent or adult life when they have been untreated, they have been neglected. So when there is severe polycythemia, you might not be able to hear any murmur. The reason is there is no antegrade flow, the blood is extremely viscous, and in spite of no pulmonary atresia, because of the blood viscosity, you might not be able to hear the murmur. So you might diagnose this as pulmonary atresia instead of tetralogy. There is a condition which is known as L transposition of the great vessels, where actually you can palpate the component, second component of the second sound, that is P2 can be palpable. Remember that in decreased pulmonary blood flow, you should never have a palpable second sound because the P2 is soft. A palpable second heart sound always indicates pulmonary hypertension. But this is an exception to the rule of L transposition where you can have a palpable second heart sound. Usually, as I said, they have a quiet precordium, but when there is no ventricular septal defect and there is only atrial septal defect, which is responsible for causing cyanosis, then you can have a left parasternal lift. And again, as in patients without any ventricular septal defect, you can have cardiomegaly. Typically, patients of cyanotic congenital heart disease with decreased pulmonary blood flow do not have cardiomegaly. But if you have cardiomegaly, then it usually indicates that there is no ventricular septal defect. I'll show you some X-ray pictures and it will be very clear to you as to why some patients with decreased pulmonary blood flow can have cardiomegaly. The X-ray in patients of decreased pulmonary blood flow reflects the physiology. So just it reflects whatever physiology and the clinical examination. So X-ray will not show cardiomegaly. The X-ray will show dark lung fields. Basically, these are known as stringy vessels. Stringy vessels, they are very small vessels, and that is because of decreased pulmonary blood flow, because the blood flow is so little that you see a dark background in the X-ray picture. And the main pulmonary artery segment will be absent in the majority of cases because the main pulmonary artery segment is hypoplastic because of pulmonary stenosis. And I'll show you a typical X-ray of how a decreased pulmonary blood flow looks like. You can see this is a classic X-ray of a tetralogy of Fallot, the boot-shaped heart. You can also see that there is no cardiac enlargement. And you can appreciate that the lung fields are dark. That is because there are hardly any pulmonary blood vessels. If you look at it critically, you don't see any lung vessels at all. And that is because of a severe curtailment of the pulmonary blood flow. Also, you see that the aorta is enlarged. Why is the aorta enlarged? Because the blood flow, the deoxygenated blood, instead of going into the lungs, is actually being diverted into the aorta. So the aorta is actually receiving two outputs, one from the right ventricle and one from the left ventricle, and that is why it is dilated. You can see along the right heart border, you can see that the aorta is dilated. So this is a classic X-ray of a patient with decreased pulmonary blood flow. But as I said, there are exceptions. When patients of decreased pulmonary blood flow, you can have cardiomegaly. You can have the main pulmonary artery segment being prominent. When you have right aortic arch in these group of patients, usually it indicates tetralogy of Fallot. And if it is a left-sided aorta, it indicates LTG. I'll show you examples of this. Here is a patient of decreased pulmonary blood flow who has severe cyanosis, but at the same time has such severe cardiac enlargement. These are patients who have severe pulmonary stenosis, that is, they have decreased pulmonary blood flow, and it is apparent from the X-ray, you see that the lung fields are dark, but that there was no VST. Since there was no VST, the right ventricular pressure became very high, it produced severe tricuspid regurgitation, It produced right to left shunt across the atrial septum, and therefore the patient was blue, and the cardiomegaly is because of severe tricuspid regurgitation. So this is an exception to the rule that all patients with decreased pulmonary blood flow will have no cardiomegaly. Here is an X-ray of a patient with L transposition of great vessels. You compare this X-ray with this X-ray. You see that along the left heart border, there is what is known as the pulmonary bay. That means the main pulmonary artery segment is absent, and also the aorta does not occupy the left heart border. Now go back to this X-ray and you see that the whole left heart border is occupied by the ascending aorta. This typically indicates L transposition of the great vessels. Cyanosis with decreased pulmonary blood flow, the electrocardiogram will show right ventricular hypertrophy in the majority of patients. They can have either left axis deviation or they can have right axis deviation. Very rarely, patients with decreased pulmonary blood flow will have left ventricular forces. I think I'll discuss about this when I come to the ECG topic, but I'm just telling you that majority of patients will have right ventricular hypertrophy. Very rarely patients with cyanotic congenital heart disease can have left ventricular hypertrophy. We will discuss about the causes later. Majority of patients will have right axis deviation. Some patients can have left axis deviation. So I'll talk to you about this subsequently. Here is a typical example of a patient with tetralogy of Fallot. Right axis deviation, right ventricular hypertrophy. You can see that the axis is pointing towards lead 3, so it is somewhere around plus 110, and you can see V1 showing R waves and V6 showing S waves, which basically indicates right ventricular hypertrophy. So classic combination of right axis deviation and right ventricular hypertrophy. Here is an example of a patient with left axis deviation and right ventricular forces. This is a very strange combination. Usually it indicates a single ventricle physiology, but I am not going into the details at present. Another example of a patient with right axis deviation and left ventricular forces. So you can see that basically by showing these two ECGs, I want you to understand that there is a discordance between the axis and the ventricular hypertrophy. This one shows left axis deviation with right ventricular hypertrophy, and this one shows right axis deviation with left ventricular hypertrophy. So there is a discordance between the two, and whenever you have such discordance, it usually means a single ventricle physiology. Here is an example of a patient with left axis deviation and left ventricular forces. So there is concordance. Initially you saw right axis deviation and right ventricular hypertrophy. Here you are seeing left axis deviation with left ventricular hypertrophy. This is typical of tricuspid atresia. And then you have what is known as left axis deviation with right ventricular forces, but we'll discuss with this later. We then come to the second group of patients, cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow. Remember that clinical recognition of cyanosis can be very difficult in these patients. Again, if you go back to your basics, the reason is that there is increased pulmonary blood flow, and the reason why you're not able to pick up cyanosis is because of the increased flow. But these patients are cyanosed by clinical investigations, by saturations, and if you do a blood gas, if you take oxygen saturation, they will always be blue. And the reason is because, as I told you in that slide, the majority of these patients have transposition complexes. They will usually present like all patients of increased pulmonary blood flow. They will have tachypnea, they will have weight loss, they will have hyperdynamic precordium, unlike the quiet precordium of decreased pulmonary blood flow. They will have cardiac enlargement because of increased pulmonary blood flow. They will have only a short murmur, a grade 1 or a grade 2 ejection murmur. But in these group of patients, you will be able to hear a flow murmur, which is actually a mid-diastolic murmur at the apex. And as I talked to you before, the reason why you hear a flow murmur is because of the increased flow which returns back into the left atrium and into the left ventricle and produces a murmur which is similar to that of mitral stenosis, if you can understand, although there is no mitral stenosis. There will be no continuous murmur. Why? because the pulmonary artery pressures in these patients are high, so you will not hear continuous murmur. The P2 splitting, although they will always be present in these patients, unlike the ones with decreased pulmonary blood flow, it is difficult to hear them. So basically in both groups of patients you will have single second heart sound. In one, it is difficult to hear because it is very soft. In this group of patients, it is difficult to hear because, as I told you, the pulmonary artery is usually posterior because of transposition. So if you notice the difference, in one, it is difficult to hear because it is very soft. In this group of patients, it is difficult to hear because although it is loud, the pulmonary second heart sound, the pulmonary artery is situated posteriorly, and therefore you are not able to hear it. Sometimes you can hear diastolic murmur at the second left interspace, that is because of regurgitation across the atrioventricular valves, semilunar valves. And if you can hear this, then it typically indicates truncus arteriosus. The X-ray again reflects the physiology. It will show cardiomegaly. It will show increased pulmonary blood flow, what we call as the plethoric lung fields. Pulmonary artery segment will be absent because the great vessels are transposed. In decreased pulmonary blood flow, the pulmonary artery segment was not seen because it is small, because of decreased pulmonary blood flow. Here, you will not see the main pulmonary artery because it is transposed, that is, it is lying posteriorly. But in one group of these patients, the pulmonary artery will be prominent, and that is total anomalous pulmonary venous connection. I'll show you the X-ray picture, it will be very clear. Then finally, in some of these patients, you can have right aortic arch, and it is said that in a patient with increased pulmonary blood flow, if you have a right aortic arch, it most commonly indicates a truncus arteriosus. So let me go back again to one of this X-ray of a decreased pulmonary blood flow. And you see that there is no cardiomegaly, and you see dark lung fields. Also, you don't see the pulmonary artery at all. There is concavity at the area where you should have pulmonary artery. Here, you don't see the pulmonary artery because it is small, hypoplastic, because of pulmonary stenosis. And now look at this X-ray, typical X-ray of an increased pulmonary blood flow. You see cardiac enlargement. You see that the lungs are very white because of increased pulmonary blood flow. But at the same time, you don't see the main pulmonary artery because there is a concavity at the area where the main pulmonary artery should be present. But here, the reason is that the pulmonary artery is lying posterior, and that is because of transposition. So this is very important for you to understand. Another example, much more classical, cardiac enlargement, increased pulmonary blood flow, main pulmonary artery segment is absent. We call it as a narrow pedicle. The pedicle is narrow because the pulmonary artery segment does not come at the area where it should be. It is lying posteriorly. This is an example which is an exception to the rule that all cyanotic patients with increased pulmonary blood flow will have transposition of great vessel. This is a classic appearance of a total anomalous pulmonary venous connection. It is called the figure of 8 appearance. You can see the two. If you join the two, you see a figure of 8 appearance, and that is because of total anomalous pulmonary venous connection. And you can also see in the shadow the main pulmonary artery segment is seen normally. The ECG might not be very contributory in patients of increased pulmonary blood flow with cyanosis. And it will be very similar to a patient of increased pulmonary blood flow without cyanosis. For example, a patient with large VST. Both of them will show biventricular hypertrophy. Whereas in patients of decreased flow, you either showed right ventricle or left ventricular hypertrophy. Most commonly, right ventricular hypertrophy. Here you will see biventricular hypertrophy. The reason is there is an increased flow into the left-sided circulation also because of the large VST. Here is a typical example of a patient with biventricular hypertrophy. You can see lead V1 showing R waves. At the same time, you can see what is known as the KW phenomena. V3, V4, V5 shows large equiphasic complexes indicating of biventricular hypertrophy. So the ECG is not very contributory in patients of increased pulmonary blood flow with cyanosis because they follow a uniform pattern in all the groups. The axis deviation, as I showed you, will follow the same pattern as that of decreased pulmonary blood flow. I'll come to this in my subsequent talk. You have then come to the third group of patients who have cyanosis with normal blood flow, pulmonary blood flow. And there are only two examples of this. One is pulmonary AV fistula, and the second condition is a much more rarer condition where the left superior vena cava drains into the left atrium. In pulmonary AV fistula, you have cyanosis because the pulmonary venous blood directly gets shunted into the pulmonary artery blood directly gets shunted into the pulmonary veins without undergoing oxygenation and reaches the left atrium directly. So the deoxygenated blood in the pulmonary artery reaches the pulmonary vein directly without getting oxygenated, and that is why it is called a fistula. And that finally reaches the systemic circulation and produces cyanosis. In patients of left SVC to LA, it is very easy to understand why the patient is blue, because all the deoxygenated blood from the superior vena cava, instead of reaching the right atrium and going into the pulmonary circulation for deoxygenation, directly connects into the left atrium and causes cyanosis. In all these patients, these two group of patients, they have typical clinical features. One, they have a quiet precordium. They'll have no murmurs in the precordium. So you will not be able to hear any murmur in the precordium. Rarely patients of pulmonary AV fistula, you can hear continuous murmur in the periphery, that is along the lung fields, but they will never have murmur in the precordium. They will always have normally split second heart sound. The X-ray may help in reaching a diagnosis. It is difficult or impossible to diagnose left SVC to left atrium by X-ray because it is always normal. But AV fistula, sometimes you can diagnose by X-ray. If you look at this X-ray which I am going to show you, you see a small patch in the left side, left lower lobe of the lung, and that patch is in a patient of a pulmonary AV fistula. Remember that this patch means nothing if you look at it in isolation, but in a patient who is blue, who has normally split second heart sound, who has a quiet precordium, no cardiac enlargement, normal ECG, if you see this patch, it is classical of pulmonary AV fistula. So these things should always be taken into combination and not in isolation. In isolation, you can diagnose this as pneumonia. I mean, this patient has a patch on the left lower lobe, so it has pneumonia. So it has no meaning if you take it in isolation. And then finally, we have what is known as the Eisenmenger physiology. Remember that patients with Eisenmenger physiology will also always be blue. Eisenmenger physiology is common to all patients with increased pulmonary blood flow, and it is a developmental phase where increased pulmonary blood flow has been untreated. They have pulmonary hypertension and they develop pulmonary vascular obstructive disease. Even these patients will have a quiet precordium. There will be no cardiomegaly, no murmur, and there will be a single sound which will be loud and palpable. So this is how they differ from decreased pulmonary blood flow. The ECG is very rarely helpful because Eisenmenger itself means pulmonary hypertension, so the ECG will show right ventricular hypertrophy and right axis deviation in all group of patients. X-ray will not show cardiomegaly. It will show very large pulmonary arteries and a cutoff sign, which is typical. If you look at this X-ray, you can see the huge main pulmonary artery, and you see good sized pulmonary artery at the hilum, but you don't see any pulmonary artery in the periphery. So this is typically called the cutoff sign, typical of Eisenmenger physiology. There is no cardiac enlargement if you see. Finally, echocardiography remains the mainstay in diagnosis. It provides us the exact anatomical diagnosis. It gives us the physiological classification. It gives us an estimate of the PA pressure. It gives us the estimate of ventricular function. And finally tells us what type of repair is needed. But before that, you have to go through this classification and clinical evaluation. So in summary, ladies and gentlemen, majority of cyanotic congenital heart disease can be categorized into physiological groups. It is not important to have an exact clinical anatomical diagnosis. because echocardiography has exposed a lot of loopholes in our clinical diagnosis. Sometimes we think what it is, but echocardiography shows something very different. There are also problems in clinical diagnosis, especially when you look at neonates. They have very fast heart rates, so it is difficult to pick up these murmurs. They have a changing physiology. Their pulmonary vascular resistance keeps on changing. In adults, sometimes it becomes difficult to hear the heart sounds and murmurs. Polycythemia can mask murmurs. So these are some of the pitfalls of clinical examination.
Thank you very much, Dr. Radhakrishnan.